A very good morning all, and on behalf of Pune Knowledge Cluster, I welcome you to the second session of this Journey of Innovation course that we are doing. And we have our speaker, Dr. Aditya Gondhalekar, here today for the second session. And over to you, Aditya. So one sort of note we want to share with the participants is that we won't be sharing the attendance form with you, because we will be directly considering your Zoom attendance, because Zoom also generates a sort of attendance which gives that for how many minutes, how many hours you have attended a particular meeting, which is more authentic way of considering the attendance. Yeah, so we'll consider that and we won't be sending you an attendance form. Just a note. Yes, thank you. Over to you, Aditya.
Thanks, Prachi, and welcome all. For the second course, second lecture in the series of three lectures. And let me share my screen and we can start. Again, Prachi, what probably I will do as a, you know, as a process is at a logical step in between, you know, in between the lecture, I would probably ask you to unmute everyone,
yeah, or so,
you know, change that setting,
right,
so that they can unmute and ask questions.
Okay,
and then,
so,
you know, you can change the setting back.
Right. So I will do that right away. We have very responsible participants over here and we know that nothing haywire will happen during the session. So I will just do that right away. Currently, everybody is on mute, but yeah, whenever you feel like, you know, asking a question or saying something, putting a comment, you can unmute yourself and do that. Yes.
Perfect.
Thanks.
They could raise their hands and accordingly Aditya can see them and then
Yeah,
that also is possible, or they can directly also do that.
Okay, perfect. So can someone just confirm that they can see my screen?
Yes, we can see the entire desktop.
Yes.
Okay, and you can also see the Zoom thing on the right hand side corner?
No, we can't see that.
Okay, the Zoom window you can't see, right?
Oh, actually, this is your Zoom window, which we can see.
I don't
know. Let me just confirm. But
no,
that is fine.
We will see our own. We will not see
we'll
yours.
See our own,
yeah.
Okay, perfect. Let me just minimize my window because I'm not able to see my full screen.
Mm.
No.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, just one, I forgot to tell the participants that please log in. See, over here, we can see 1 hour if Bhushan Chaudhary. Then somebody, we also saw Dell or something like that. So be careful, please log in by your first name and followed by surname, because that is going to tell us that you were present for the session. We will be searching this in the attendance, Zoom attendance. We can see somebody 107F1B09. Please rename yourself. Yeah, thanks.
Okay. All right. So just quick refresh of our last class. And I hope it's just 1 week, so everyone remembers what we went through last week, last Saturday. We initially started with the definition of innovation, and I talked about various innovation experts being asked what is the definition of innovation, and you know, you get different results or different answers, but it all boils down to three things which are core to innovation. First is it has to be new in the context, so new to the company, new to the nation, you know, new to the market or the country that you are living in. It has to be executed or applied, so it can't be a PowerPoint or something which is still on paper. It has to be executed. And the last thing is it should generate stakeholder value, and it could be any stakeholder, right? So it could be your company which profits from it, or it could be the environment which gets benefited from it, or it could be your country or whoever. So there has to be an identified stakeholder and there has to be a stakeholder value. So these three, we agreed that yes, we will probably, you know, consolidate all those definitions that are floating around, and we'll say if you have these three elements, then we can call it as innovation. Then we also looked at what is the difference between innovation and invention. And I think that was very important, because again, these two words sometimes are used interchangeably, which is not true. So invention is something which is original in absolute sense, which may or may not have a realized stakeholder value. So it would have a potential stakeholder value, but it might not be realized. Whereas innovation is, you know, again, it is for the context, and it is already generating stakeholder value. So we have kind of defined these two and, you know, identified the difference. Then we went and said that, okay, I mean, there would be innovations which would fail commercially. And that's perfectly fine. You know, it's nowhere in the definition of innovation, you know, the commercial success comes in, right? And we saw some examples like Kodak and, you know, Segway and other things where the innovations, really good innovations, technical technology innovations, which failed in commercial sense because of so many reasons. So it could be they were too early to the market, they were too, too short-sighted, you know, not seeing the future, and, you know, so many reasons for different failures. Then we went on and said, what are the types of innovation? And we saw the wheel of innovation, you know, 10 types of innovation, but, you know, grouped into three main areas. One is configuration, the second one is experience and offering. And we also saw some example of each one of these. Then we said that, okay, innovation is not something only related to big ideas, transformation. Innovation is a spectrum. So it could be something very small, which you improve in your current product, current service, current process. That is also equally a valid innovation as probably an Uberization of the world where, you know, you completely change the game. So we said that, yes, innovation is a spectrum. You have core innovations, you have adjacent, and, you know, you have transformational innovation. And we also said that, you know, based on the business and the technology, so the McKinsey 2x2 metric or 3x3 metric of innovation, we studied and we said horizon 1, horizon 2, horizon 3 innovations, and, you know, some examples of that as well. And we probably, you know, ended our session last time with a question, a valid question, a dilemma in everyone's mind, typically who, you know, is an innovator, that what should be the currency of innovation? Whether we should consider ideas as our currency, that, okay, you know, my organization or, you know, I have generated 500 ideas, you know, so would that be the currency of innovation or the measure of success of innovation, or the other one, which is, you know, solving the problem. So, you know, we have solved 4 problems, 5 problems. What should be the currency? And I think there is no one answer to that. And because, so seemingly it seems that, you know, problem statement should be or number of problems that you solve should be the currency. But what happens is sometimes problems are not very specified, or, you know, they are kind of unmet, unexpressed needs of customers. And there needs to be, you know, another currency, which is ideas, to be able to even unearth those problems, bring it to surface and then solve it. So, you know, it has to be a balanced approach in terms of how you should measure innovation. You should measure also based on the number of ideas that you have generated or your organization has generated, and also the number of problems solved. So that's where we kind of ended our last session. And this session would consist of mainly the process of innovation and the tools that we use during innovation. But just before going into the process, there are, you know, a couple of concepts that I wanted to really cover in the last lecture, which we couldn't because of time constraints. So I'll just quickly cover those, and then we will move to the process of innovation, right? So if you see this graph, you know, on the y-axis you have where the innovation actually is triggered, you know, so whether it is triggered within a particular organization, and here by organization I mean, you know, informal formal organization, it is whether it is a group of people, whether it is a formal commercial organization or a nation, or so it's essentially that group that I'm calling an organization. And on x-axis, you have the time zone, approximate time zone. So what has happened is so from earlier times until probably 1990s, the innovation was mainly, in a very specific area of R&D, right? So it all started with technology push. So people who are working in R&D, who are working in, scientists who are working in various disciplines, they come up with discovery, which is invention in our definition. And they said, okay, I mean, I think this discovery can be used, or this invention can be used to generate this stakeholder value. Yeah. And then they started using that to push the products into the market. So it was all technology push type of innovation. So people were pushing the new discoveries, new technologies into market, and the market was getting generated to use those technologies. Then we moved into a more matured customer arena, where the market started pulling. The market started telling the the scientists and the engineers that, okay, I want this. And to cater to that need, the R&D engineers started building things, or started coming up with products. So that was a pull, market pull type of innovation. Later on, in the first one, technology push type of innovation, who were the key players? They were the product R&D people. So whether it's a scientist in a pharmaceutical company, or a engineer in an automotive company, so they were the real innovators in that. In the market pull, obviously they were there, but then marketing department of all organizations also started playing a major role, because how you would get otherwise the market pull or market sentiment? So the marketing people started going out and asking voice of customer and all those things, and getting what is needed. So marketing also started playing into the innovation area. Later on, essentially the whole industry realized that it's a mix. It's not only technology push, neither it is only market pull. It should be coupled. So then they're formed a nice circular 360 degree process, where you go to market, you ask people, or you ask your consumer what you need. R&D also kind of comes up with their product, they push it. So it's kind of a coupled. But the whole era was, if you see, was driven by the organization. Yeah. So there wasn't really an ecosystem play there. It was essentially driven by the core expertise of that company. If it is a pharmaceutical company, then probably the R&D of that, the drug discovery and chemical molecules discovery was the place. That was the very small place where all the innovations used to happen. If it is a aerospace company, then the material scientist or the engine designers would come up with innovation. So it was, you can imagine that if it's a 100,000 people company, like a GE or a Boeing, or only a handful of people were the innovators, and the rest of the people in the company were more or less following or executing whatever is innovated. Then in 2000 onwards, we saw a completely different trend in the market, and that is mainly because of the uprise of the IT and digital that has the digital phenomena that has happened. And the information suddenly became almost available and free because of Google and all the World Wide Web. And now anyone in the organization can have a good idea, and that idea can be converted, obviously, by some people. But essentially, it started a entire phase of a diffusion-based innovation, which means that that group of engineers in Boeing, say 200 R&D engineers, they were still center stage of innovation, but they were getting actually ideas and the solutions from all different people. Because essentially knowledge has become now open and available to everyone. later on, it also was realized that, you know, sum is always, you know, the whole is always more than sum of its parts. So rather than Boeing alone coming up with, you know, something which is innovative, what if Boeing, you know, works with, say, G, which is an engine manufacturer, and, you know, SNECMA, which is a, you know, helicopter design. So so the whole network-based innovation started coming in. And that's where the partners and even the crowd. So, you know, if you see, even today, there are so many innovation challenges which are outsourced to the crowd. So which is called as crowdsourcing, right? So that has started becoming very popular because somebody sitting in, you know, remote part of India could easily now solve a problem which a Boeing engineer was, you know, was thinking of, because of internet, because of, you know, availability of data resources, etc. So this is how the innovation has changed. So in today's world, it is no longer only the R&D folks who are innovating. It is essentially the whole organization that can innovate. At least they have the capability. I mean, it depends on also the passion and the liking of people if they want to really go and innovate. But at least now it is an open field where everyone can innovate, including us. So NASA releases a lot of problem statements to public, right? I mean, earlier, if you were to, you know, work on a NASA problem, you had to go through all the drill of, you know, having a really good engineering or science degree, then PhD, and then, you know, appearing for their interview and actually going into NASA and solving their problem. Nowadays, I mean, they openly share their problems, obviously at an abstract level, not, you know, not giving any IP or copyright of theirs. But, you know, now it is at least possible to for you also to solve those problems. Yeah. So what happened because of that is now today's and future innovation is driven by the whole ecosystem play. And the people or the organizations who have understood the importance of this open innovation, they are essentially you know, winning today. So it's all about that innovation inclusivity. Earlier, it was a very niche skill. It was a elite club that, okay, I mean, he or she works in R&D department. I mean, that was kind of, you know, seen very differently. Nowadays, it's more of innovation inclusivity that, yes, you know, all people in my organization, whether it is a CEO or a head of R&D or even a sweeper who, you know, sweeps the floor, they have an idea to, or they have a potential to innovate. And a very good example I will share about this is, you know, Heathrow Airport, which is London's biggest airport, UK's biggest airport. If you go there as a passenger, you know, on each of the assets that they have. So, for example, if you have an elevator, if you have an escalator which goes up and down, or if you have a baggage belt, or if you have a water fountain. Now, at each of those assets, there is a tag, there is a QR code, and which encourages people to actually give them ideas about that particular thing. For example, if water fountain is leaking, or if water fountain height is not probably you know, suitable for children or people with lower height, you know, you can quickly scan the QR code and give your ideas of, you know, how you can do it better. So imagine the way that Heathrow Airport is collecting that ideas from, you know, millions of passengers that visit that airport. So it's really game changing the way the whole innovation you know, play is changing. Yeah, and what is evident there is now, if you see the most valuable brand. So this is 2020 list. I couldn't get a 2021 list, but, you know, it's 2020, it's just a COVID era. So, you know, you can just consider this as probably not too apart in time. So in 2020, if you see the most valuable brands, yeah, Amazon, Google, Apple, Samsung, you know these products and you know these companies. They are really innovative companies. They are digital masters in their game. And they are actually, you know, in the top 10 brands. And even if you expand this list to top 50, you will see companies like this, Facebook, Walmart, right? You're not seeing the brick and mortar companies here, unfortunately. You are not seeing a BMW or a or a General Motors or, you know, these kind of companies here, which is very interesting. So what is happening is the innovative companies are also the most valuable companies. And in my opinion, and, you know, in experts' opinion across the globe, I think this will continue at least for some good amount of time, because, you know, it's kind of a vicious circle in a positive way. It's a self-enforcing circle that if you have smart people, if you have a very good culture to innovate, you innovate more, you kind of grow, you have more to spend, right? So it's kind of a self-enforcing circle that these companies have already entered. So, all right. So I think this is where, you know, we wanted to really stop in our last lecture. But any questions on this before we start going into the process of innovation?
So participants can raise their hands, they can unmute themselves and ask questions.
No?
Maybe at a later stage they might.
Perfect. That's fine. So let's go to now the process of innovation. So there is a common feeling amongst you know, people who actually see innovation from a further end. So you're not really into the innovation ecosystem. You're not actually in the innovation department or a discipline. And you tend to believe that it is, you know, a spark of idea which comes in your sleep sometimes. And that triggers the whole, you know, light bulb movement, right? So the light bulb movements are important, no doubt about those. But there is a rigorous process which is followed or which should be followed to drive any innovation. And now it is, there are no two opinions about it. Every organization kind of has realized it and have established, you know, the variation or a variant of a process which we'll see today in their own, own departments. So we will go through the innovation process. It starts with two forks, you know, two end of the forks. So the first one is problem, right? So the problem, essentially, as we said, you know, something which is not working properly, something which is not right, which is not efficient, you know, it starts from there, or it starts from inspiration. So inspiration is essentially whatever you see as, you know, as what your competition is doing, or even in some cases, a cross-fertilization of things. So something which is great, which is happening in probably COVID administration of, you know, how the drug was administered and how it was given to, you know, 100,000 people, you know, in very short amount of time, etc., could trigger an inspiration for, you know, a company which is probably managing some kind of network of people or computers or machines, right? So the cross fertilization as well as within industry inspiration could be the second end of the fork. So the whole innovation process starts from these two. Once you have the problem, you essentially go and ideate, right? So you generate ideas on top of the problem that you have. You know, the start of the ideation always is with unconstrained nature. So, you know, you ideate for plenty. So you probably would start with 1,000 ideas, and then you start the filtering process and, you know, filter it down to, you know, very few ideas which you can work on, the handful of ideas which, you know, are workable, right? So once you have ideas, you go and try to, so idea is not a solution. So I think there is a difference between these two, and, you know, it's very important to understand that. So the idea probably is where, so take a problem of traffic, you know. So there is too much of a traffic in Pune city where I live. So if that is the problem statement, there would be multiple ideas of, you know, okay, then we can have you know, bigger roads, we can have metro to essentially move people to a public transport. There could be bus lane in between. These are all ideas, right? Then after you have ideas, after you select ideas, you actually start solutioning those ideas, which means that you have to essentially work out how this exactly would work in practice, how it interact with the super system. For example, if you talk about BRT, bus rapid transport system that has been built, right? So it is essentially, the idea is probably that can we have something which is which moves faster on a specific road. So can we have a road dedicated to bus, right? So that was probably the idea. When it comes to solutioning, probably the government would have said, okay, can we build a road somewhere else where only the buses can go? And then as they start solutioning and putting the constraints, removing the constraints, they would have come up with a solution or an architecture of, okay, if you have big road, reserve the mid lane for buses, and then they will rapidly pass through that. Now there would also be some constraints or how it works with the super system. So what happens with the bus stops, because you can't really stop in between the road, right? There has to be some bus stop in between. Now if the height of that bus stop is elevated, and if the channel through which the bus passes is very narrow, then how the passengers would alight and onboard the bus, then there has to be kind of an elevated or a different gate for bus to actually work in this area. So essentially that is a component where it starts interacting with the system, and that's the solutioning part. Once you have the solution, the first thing that you need to do is you need to try that concept, the proof of concept. So the proof of concept, POC, is essentially checking whether the intended task with the intended solution can be achieved, right? So it's a technical / organizational / political feasibility of that. So whether it is possible to do that. So that's the proof of concept. Usually it is done in a very kind of very economically effective way. We don't need to spend too much of effort and money onto that, because it is just validating that concept. After you have proof of concept, there is something called as proof value. So now, okay, this concept works, right? I mean, you can create a bus and a road, and you can have this concept, but would it really make business sense? And business sense essentially doesn't only mean the financial sense, but also it is a business value or stakeholder value sense. So would people who actually want to travel from one point to another really get benefited from this? So that is proof of value. So technically it works, but would it work in real sense? That is a proof of value. This is also a very quick and quick way done in an isolated manner to identify the real value that we will get from this. Then comes pilot. Again, people sometimes use proof of concept and pilot very interchangeably, which is not again true, which is not correct. So pilot is a full system that you have designed. So if it's a BRT system, as we are taking this example, it is a full BRT system deployed for only one stretch of Pune. For example, if one road is selected as a pilot road, and if you build a full BRT system with buses and roads and bus stops and everything, that is the pilot. So you are not actually implementing it for the whole Pune city, but you are actually choosing a road, you're piloting it. The pilot, what is the purpose of pilot? It is essentially trial. So you are learning a lot of shortfalls or a lot of challenges, constraints, obstacles that you will face through this pilot stage. Once you have the pilot, you learn the lessons from the pilot, then the last stage is where you scale up. And you say that, okay, BRT has worked really well on this road. we have learned the lessons, now we have captured the lessons, we have modified our solution, and then you scale it. You scale it at a full city level or even a full state level or whatever. So this is how the whole innovation process works. Now, there is a set of iterations that happen across, and this is very important to understand and know that it is not a linear process. It is kind of an iterative process, and iteration can happen from anywhere until pilot. Usually the iteration should not happen after scaling, because then you have not deployed the innovation process well, because most of the learnings, most of the knowledge about the system, the knowledge about your solution, you should be able to get at the stage of pilot. Now, why I have colored these iterations in different colors? Because each iteration has a different impact. So see the iteration which is coming from, say, pilot to solution architecture, which means that you pilot it on one road, this BRT system, and you say, this is not working. I think we need to have a bigger track, because the people are not able to alight properly, etc. It's not safe. And then you change something about the solution itself, right? Or it could be right at the stage of proof of concept. You try to design a bus which passes through the tunnel, and they say, the design is not technically feasible. I think we need to change the design of that bus so that it kind of moves from one place to other properly. So these are the iterations which happen from various stages to solutioning. Sometimes, the iteration can also happen right at the stage of idea. So if you do this pilot, and if the pilot is not successful to the extent, you might challenge the idea of having a separate track for the BRT. You can probably say, this probably is not working in this city or this country. Can we actually generate more ideas to solve the same problem of traffic? So it could also be at the stage of ideas. It could kind of iterate back to the stage of ideas. In very few cases, but it happens. After the pilot and the realizations and the learnings from the pilot, it could well be going to the problem statement itself. So you can actually go and ask problem that, are we solving the right problem, or are we probably solving the wrong problem? So there is too much of trapping in the city, and if you try to solve this problem in Pune city, right now your problem domain is Pune city hai, usme traffic hai, you want to reduce it. When the red iteration, which goes back from the pilot to problem statement, would probably challenge the problem itself, saying that, do you really want to solve this problem this way, or probably you want to put it in a put a different spin on the problem and say that, why don't we have 10 cities which are tier 2 cities currently, and improve their infrastructure so that people from different places of Maharashtra or India do not come to Pune, and then it becomes more distributed population, and hence it solves that problem, but it doesn't solve it at a Pune city level, but it solves it at a larger level. So even that can happen. And the time that you take to make these iterations is also very important. Because the longer you take to make these iterations, the expensive the iteration would become. So anything that happens from scaling up and going back to changing the solution, etc., it is probably the worst story. And a lot of money, effort, time is wasted on that. So this is essentially the innovation process. It's a fail fast process, so that it kind of gives you an option or gives you a lot of opportunities to actually quickly test your solution, go back, change the architecture, again try the solution. So it's kind of iterative fail fast type of approach that that we usually take any innovations through. Any questions on the innovation process? No? Okay. In between also, if you have any questions, please raise your hand and we can go back to this slide and clarify. That's perfectly fine. Okay, let's come to this term, which is probably in the market, it's a very hot term in the market, design thinking, right? Most of you might have heard this statement or heard this terminology. Can you raise your hands if you have heard about design thinking, or if you have kind of worked in design thinking? You have one hand raised, two hand raised. Just two people have heard about design thinking? Okay. Okay, very few people, which is interesting, because if you are anywhere closer to the innovation, this has been the talk of the town. I mean, everybody talks about design thinking. But what I wanted to tell you is a very quick history of design thinking. So design thinking was, I won't say it was coined by IDEO, but it was kind of popularized by IDEO. IDEO is a consulting organization, a very niche innovation consulting organization. And Tim Brown, who is the chief chair, executive chair of IDEO, he kind of popularized this term of design thinking. And what it said that the innovation process that you earlier saw in the earlier slide, right? It is essentially following the same innovation process. But what this actually highlights is a human-centered approach to innovation. So usually, again, going back to the evolution of innovation, right? Earlier, it was all about, okay, I have this technology, I'm pushing it. But now, you know, can you actually involve the end users or the humans who are actually going to use this system right at the start of the process, and then really understand what is their pain point, right? So involving people or users right from the start in the process is essentially the core of design thinking. Many times it is represented using this double diamond. This is called as double diamond. So it starts with the problem statement again, as you see. You go, how do you understand a problem statement? It's a different thing. So you go with a very observable problem statement that comes to you. Then you talk to users, end users. So in our case, now we'll continue with the same example that we were taking of traffic in Pune city. So you will get this problem statement from various places. Okay, there is a lot of traffic in Pune city. You might observe it yourself also, etc. Right? So that's the problem statement. Now you empathize. So you empathize with the citizens of Pune city. So you go and talk, you interview citizens, you interview the whole different personas. So you go and interview the elderly people who, you know, who go and, you know, have to work. You interview the working people of age, probably 25 to 60, who are actually committing to their work every day. You work, you interview the children about their experience going from school to home, home to school, etc. So to essentially take different sections of the society, who would eventually be the users, because this is a public infrastructure, so every citizen would use it. So, and you essentially understand what it feels to be in their shoes. So that's where you understand the user needs. So that is the divergence. So, you know, you actually grow, you talk to many people. But now there is a tricky thing there, because the granulated problem statements that you will get from a person who is commuting would be different than people who are kind of laborers and they are, you know, traveling through buses, than to people who are elderly and their daily commute is just from their home to their bank to, you know, draw their pension and come back home, right? So each one will tell you a different problem. So which problem to solve? That's a trickier thing now. So after you empathize, which is divergence, you have to converge. You have to say, okay, I mean, I have heard about all the stories of the end users, but now I think it is me who would essentially identify a very specific problem. And that's where you essentially identify this problem. Now, again, you ideate. So you explore for possibilities. So that is, again, a divergence, right? So there's a second diamond starting. So that's a second diamond divergence where you ideate with multiple ideas about how to solve this problem, and again you converge with a solution. So this is essentially design thinking. And in my view, again, it's my personal view, but the traditional or the conventional innovation process that has been used is no different than design thinking. Probably the strength of design thinking comes from that first empathize box, where that's key, because as typical scientists or engineers, they used to miss that first part. That okay, they are so excited about their discovery or their engineered product that they really forget to ask users what they want. So I think that empathize part is very important, and that differentiates design thinking from a traditional or conventional innovation process. So just wanted to highlight that design thinking is what we will be learning. It's not completely different. There are 2-day, 2-month, 2-year courses even on design thinking, because it's not about what you see on the slides. It's about practicing it in your day-to-day work, practicing it with your day-to-day problem statement, right? So that actually needs a way longer conversation than probably what we could do in this short period of time. Any questions on this? No? All right. Just checking time. Yeah, we are on time. Right. So now what we are going to do is we will take each step of this whole process, and we will see which tools typically we use. These are tools which are available. Again, it needs a lot of practicing. So as part of this course, I will state the tool. I will state how typically it is used. I will probably give one example of using that tool, but we will stop there. The practicing part has to be done by you and on your problem statements, right? So the first segment of the innovation process is a problem, right? Problem identification and definition. And one of the very powerful techniques that is very commonly used is 5 whys, and you might have used it during your outside innovation also. It's a very powerful technique to go to the crux of the problem, so to say, right? Usually what happens is the problem that is seemingly there, it is at a very surface level. It is an observable problem. You need to actually ask 1 why, 2 why, to go to the depth of the problem. And 5 whys, it's usually, why 5 whys and why not 4 why or 3 whys, is because it is seen typically that after, if you are able to, even the most complex of the problems, if you are able to ask 5 why questions, then you will reach to the bottom of the problem. And it, in my experience, it hardly, for me, it never takes 5 whys. It usually, in 2 or 3 whys, you reach to the root of the problem. But that the name suggests 5 whys, so just wanted to clarify that, right? So I'll take the example so that it is very clear. So this example we will kind of continue for all the tools, or at least some of the tools are there. So there is this company which is a leader in oil filtration system. So this company, what it does is it produces or design and manufactures a system, oil filtration system, which is installed on offshore oil extraction units, right? And as the oil is extracted from offshore units, it essentially filters that oil and gives you a purified oil, right? Now these people are technologically advanced, right? Absolutely amazing technology. Their competitors are way behind them, et cetera, et cetera. But they are facing a decline in profit despite of all these leadership positions and brilliant technology. Now, this is essentially the problem. Let's see what is the observable problem. So observable problem is the problem that is actually seen on the surface. So I formulate this observable problem as the company profits are declining in a growing market. Yeah, so it's a growing market. It's not a shrinking market. So the market is growing, the profits are declining. So this is my problem. I ask why the profits are declining. So the highlighted and colored thing is where we ask why. So I say, okay, I understand the profits are declining in growing market. Why the profits are declining? I get the next question or next statement. The sales are stagnant while the costs are increasing with inflation. So now I go to the level below. And they okay, profit decline ho rahe, but I get a new insight now as after asking one of my question is, okay, the sales are not growing, but the costs are growing, which means that, you know, you're selling the same number of units for the same price or whatever, and the costs are growing up. So obviously the difference between top line and your cost is what, you know, bottom line is, which is your profit, which is declining. Okay. Then I say, okay, but you're saying that it's a growing market. So why sales are stagnant? So I ask the second why. Now I get a third answer or a third statement saying that we are unable to fulfill the order book. Okay. Now I'm getting, you know, to one level below saying that, okay, so you are saying that sales are stagnant, but sales are not stagnant because we are not getting customer demand or we are not getting customer orders. We are getting customer orders, but we are not able to fulfill those orders. That's the third level statement after why. I say, okay, why we are unable to fulfill the order book? Then, you know, I get two statements now here. First statement is, you know, quality checking queues up. So, you know, after we design and manufacture our product, it goes through the quality gate, and the quality checking takes too much of time. And hence we are not able to, you know, ship the number of units as probably we would want to do. The second is our suppliers do not meet their time commitment. So, you know, as probably we are not doing everything in-house, we are dependent on our supply chain, and our suppliers are not probably sending their parts, their subsystems, etc. in time, and hence it delays this. Now, if you see, this gives me a very good, you know, statement or a problem to work on. If you now compare this with a higher level problem of profits are declining, it's very difficult to solve that problem on its surface. But if you kind of go down, then probably these two problems are solvable problems. Yeah, I think somebody has raised a hand. If you have a question, please unmute yourself and you can ask. Was it Vignesh? Or you raised and lowered your hand? Was it by mistake? Any questions? I think it was by accident. No problem. Yeah. So this is the first technique that typically we will use, which is five whys. And using this technique, you go to, you know, a surface, from a surface level problem to few levels down until you are confident that, you know, you can solve this problem. And there it could actually, you know, an increasing funnel, you know, a reverse funnel, where you start with one problem, which is a surface level problem. And as you go a level down, it could be kind of a reverse funnel where you'll have six or seven problems, essentially, which is contributing to that one surface level problem, which is fine, because then you have very pointed problems. And if you solve these six problems or, you know, some of these problems, then automatically you are solving the surface level problem. Yeah. So this is a very important technique in terms of identifying the problem. Yeah. Are we solving the right problem? You have to go to the right level. Now, the second technique in the same area of problem identification and problem definition is formulation of that problem. So, you know, it's called as HMW, how might we? Kind of very standard way to formulate your problem. So the moment you have the problem, you need now to formulate that problem using how might we question. How might we solve this problem, right? But while you do that, you have to identify the people who would be kind of working as part or getting affected as part of this whole problem and solution. the actual need and also some constraints, if they are there, which are immovable. So the things which we cannot really, you know, change as the problem. So again, we'll see the same example. So we had kind of identified two problems going by three whys, and the one was quality checks take time. The second one was supply chain. But let's take now the quality checks are queued up and takes too long. Now, this is a statement. Now, how you convert that into a problem statement using how might we is like this. How might we reduce the time taken for quality checks, because you know, it's taking time, without compromising the process, so that the quality engineers can finish more products per day and the customers get their order on time. Yeah. So what are the color items here? They are very important. The first blue color item is a core need or core problem. So reduce time taken for quality checks. Yeah. The second one in yellow is the constraint. We cannot really change the quality ka process because it is, you know, it's probably, you know, what they need to follow as a compliance or regulation or whatever. So you can't say, quality check ka time kam karna hai, let's, you know, skip this process or skip these steps in the process so that you get time. So that's the constraint, which is immovable because probably it is coming from a regulation or a, you know, something which is related to government, etc. Then we identify also the stakeholders. So by solving this problem, who are getting benefited or who are getting affected? So first is the quality engineers, right? So we have to, again, go back and connect to the design thinking part. So now we are talking about empathy. So now after this problem, we will obviously talk to the stakeholders, talk to the customers and quality engineers, ki kyun problem aa raha tumhe, or, you know, if this problem gets solved, how you will feel, right? So for that, it is very important to identify the stakeholders also. So this is how a typical problem, which was written as a statement, in this case, quality checks are queued up, takes too long, is converted into how might we problem statement, where you identify the core need, you identify the stakeholders, and you also identify the immovable constraints. Clear? Any question on the first two methods that we, or two tools that we kind of learned? One is the five whys and the second one is now the how might we. No? Okay. I'll go to the next one. Now we are actually moving into the phase of idea generation. Yeah. So we studied essentially the problem. We went to the depth of problem, we defined the problem, we converted into how might we. Now we have to generate ideas on that. And usually brainstorming is probably the most popular way to generate ideas. And to date, it has remained as the most widely used technique. It is important to have few things as part of brainstorming. First is, the group of people has to be really diverse, because otherwise it almost becomes, you know, everybody thinks the same way, right? Again, taking an example of Pune traffic problem. If people who are sitting in Pune city, looking at that traffic, if they are only part of that group, or rather, I would rather say even shorten the group, saying that if only commuters who travel from Pune city to IT park are considered for this brainstorming, the ideas that you will get would be very monotonous. You know, you will get the same ideas. Now add a few people who are elderlies, you will get a different perspective. Now add a few people who are children, you will get a different perspective. Now add people from a very organized city in India, like Chandigarh, right? So you add a few more people from Chandigarh, you will get a completely different perspective of how they are solving their problem. Now add, you know, people from outside India where, you know, where this problem is already solved, you'll get a different perspective, right? So for that, you know, any brainstorming, it's very important that we choose the people very carefully. We should have a diverse group of people, diversity in all sense, from the background, gender, age, and all those things. And also, solve or rather generate many ideas as possible. And there are some do's and don'ts of brainstorming, which are very important. So when we start the brainstorming, let wild ideas flow. I mean, no idea is a bad idea. So let it flow, you know, even if it is completely different idea and seemingly not attached to problem, that is perfectly fine. I think this is not a constraining phase. It is kind of a diverging phase where, you know, you can actually have multiple ideas. No idea is a bad idea, no biases. So, are ha, yeah, ye yahan se hai na. So I think that's why. So yeah, these IT people, so they will always think of this. So these are the biases, and the biases are there in everyone's mind. We cannot really, it's very difficult to live without biases, but at least for this exercise of brainstorming, we should keep our biases away and, you know, try to be as objective as possible. In companies or in institutes, it happens that there is always a boss and a subordinate type of setting in any brainstorming, and then usually that relationship ruins the brainstorming output, because, you know, you just adhere to what your boss said, right? It's just not a good thing. So usually we don't put line managers, etc., in the brainstorming. We keep them aside. If we put them, then it's very clear that for this particular 10 minute, 15 minute, he or she is not your boss, right? We have to make it very clear. And again, it's very interesting study which was done some part in Europe, where they studied that if you give too much of time for ideation, it actually, you know, flattens after some time. So, you know, in after say 10 minutes, you won't get any new ideas if you extend it to 1 hour. And if you break and if you do it probably 2 days later, you will get different ideas. But at any given point of time, you will start getting ideas, you know, you will get very good ideas for first 10 minutes, but after that, you know, it doesn't really generate new ideas. So it has to be really a time-bound activity. So first, you know, 5 to 10 minutes, and then you kind of, you know, gather together. Now there is also a kind of a process which is recommended for brainstorming. So after you have the problem identified, how might be identified, initially start with the individual expression, right? So individual expression is where you start generating ideas, but not in a group, individually. So you kind of, if you're, you know, gathered in a, you know, in a room, you kind of go in corners of the room and start thinking about this problem and ideas that you yourself are, you know, ideating. Then you join the group, and then you have a group expression, which means that you know, as a group, if you kind of start and think about new ideas, that is how it happens in a group. Later on, it is a group consolidation. So because individuals have generated their ideas, you know, you put it on post-its and on a big screen, you group those ideas. Now there would be some ideas which are repetitive. I mean, there would be a different set of words being used, but eventually it means the same thing. So consolidation is where you are actually just consolidating those ideas. You're not rejecting ideas here. Huh? So this is still a phase where you are kind of expanding. You're not throwing out ideas out yet. So consolidation is only removing the repetitions, not removing any ideas which are independent ideas. Yeah. So this is where then after you have problem, you start brainstorming, and you know, you get a set of ideas, and these are some of the rules for brainstorming. Any questions until this stage on this slide or even the earlier slides? No? Okay. We will go to the second part of idea generation, which is the 4P. This is a tool which is, you know, extremely useful. Sometimes what happens is you have given a problem statement, you sit in a brainstorming, but you are not able to generate ideas structurally, right? I mean, you are thinking, yeah, I mean, I know this is a problem, but I'm not able to generate any ideas. So there has to be some structure which kind of helps you, or a framework which helps you to generate ideas. So 4P is one such structure where we think of 4 axes. The product, process, position, and paradigm, right? And we try to expand the design space by looking at you know, one at a time. So, you know, what can we do here for this problem using a product approach, or you know, what can we do by changing the process, etc. So that is how this 4P is used. Again, we will take an example of this quality checks. I'll explain what does it really mean in terms of this 4P for the quality check problem. So product, right now, so for example, quality check is happening manually. You know, they have a pen and a paper, and then they go to the machine, they kind of start ticking all the check boxes in their checklist, you know, all manually done. On the product side, we say, can we use a newer digital tool? For example, can we use an iPad where, you know, you just point your iPad to the machine? Can there be an algorithm which kind of identifies what is wrong, or you know, what is the quality failure there, right? So that's how we start thinking about newer ideas from the product perspective. From the process perspective, we start challenging the process, saying that, okay, there are 40 checklist points to cover. Is there any way, while, you know, in the how might be statement, we have said that without altering the process, but from the idea generation point of view, it is okay. You know, you don't have to be bothered about the by the constraints. So you say, okay, out of these 40 checklist points that we have, is there any way that we can eliminate some, or we can club some so that it kind of comes down to, you know, say 30 or 25, so that it takes lesser time. So this is how we, you know, start generating ideas from the process perspective. From the position perspective, what do you mean by position? So position is either it's a physical position or a logical position in a process, or, you know, you can kind of abstract it to multiple different realities based on the problem. In this case, we can say that, can we move the quality checks at earlier stages? So you are changing the position of quality checks. You know, in current situation, say the quality checks happen after the design and manufacturing is complete, and then it moves to the quality. We say that, okay, can we move it to our suppliers, so that whenever the suppliers actually you know, supply the products to us, they already quality check it, so that we don't have to do it again. Or while the product is getting manufactured, can some parts be quality checked there and then itself, so that, you know, it doesn't come at the end of the cycle for quality checking. So this is how you're generating ideas, by changing the position of this particular item, yeah, moving it up and down the value chain. And paradigm is, I think it's difficult, and most of us would struggle generating ideas. The newer generation is better, I would say, because they don't have any baggage. But essentially, this is where we actually start asking very fundamental questions, and which are very uncomfortable also. So for example, in this case, you know, if somebody asks that, okay, why can't we embed quality in design itself, so that, you know, the whole concept of quality control, we eliminate that. So if a person who is doing quality checks for his or her life, you know, they would laugh at this particular idea, saying that, pagal hai kya, I mean, quality check and quality control is very important part of, you know, the whole manufacturing, and it can't be eliminated. But, you know, this is a paradigm shift, and probably it could be done. We don't know. I mean, this is as the process is designed today, it is needed. But if we design, if we change the design of the process completely, probably it is not needed. So these are the elements which we think of when we think of a completely paradigm shift. Any questions, any examples that you can think of particularly paradigm shift in innovation, where you see that, okay, somebody has completely thought of a completely different thing, and hence they could actually ideate in a completely different way. Anyone want to share any examples or anything that you have observed? No? Okay, so, right. So, I don't know if we are going fast and there is no kind of feedback loop. I can't see you. So I am unable to really understand whether you are getting it, whether it is too fast, too slow, right pace.
It's going on fine. Yeah. But, yes, it's going on very nicely. Maybe at the end, we might get questions.
Yeah, so
you should give some soaking time for people. Perfect. Yeah.
Okay, I think that's understandable. So, you know, we will go to the next thing now. So we studied the problem definition, problem formulation, then we came to the idea generation. We studied two methods of idea generation. Now we'll have the last method of idea generation, which is, last in a sense, these tools, and yeah, one disclaimer here. I have picked tools which typically I used, or you know, most of my colleagues and peers used in ideation and in the whole innovation process. There are multiple tools which are available. I can share you some nice websites where you know you can find these tools and go through it yourself as well. So there are many more tools also available, but considering the most common ones that I used or my teams used, I have kind of prepared this list. So the next in line is the constraint relaxation. This is very, again, this aligns with the paradigm shift kind of concept as well. So in this tool or this method, what we do is we start releasing the constraints one by one or all together, and then start asking questions. If this is not a constraint, what would happen or what kind of ideas you would generate? So you have a problem and you have typically these constraints. I mean, again, these are not this is not a holistic list of constraints, but you have, say, money constraint that you don't have enough money, or you have space constraint that you don't have space to fit this thing in, or you have people constraint where you know you say, oh, only four people are part of this, or skilled to do this job, right? So you might have time constraint. So this is again part of the resource, but you have to do it in this much time or whatever. And then you have some regulatory constraints or government constraint that, okay, this has to be done this way or that way. So this is the constraint space. So now if you see what happens is you have a problem and you have very tight constraints from all different directions. The challenge with this is that with these constraints in your mind completely at a subconscious level, you cannot really think of an idea, even if that idea would eventually solve this problem, because one of the constraints is already in your mind and hence you're not thinking of that idea. So what we do is essentially we stretch the constraints or we remove the constraints. For example, if you have a budget constraint of, say, this has to be done in 200, so 2 lakh rupees. Now 2 lakh is a constraint which is sitting in your subconscious mind. You will not really put forward an idea which would take probably 10 lakh. Even if it is a fantastic idea and solving that problem in a fraction of a second, right? So by systematically removing this constraint, the moment you remove that money constraint, you'll say, okay, I mean, if 5 lakh is not a constraint, then can we use this completely automated robot? Just giving an example, right? So that is how removing constraint helps. So I will take example which is a bit different here now. Moving away from our quality control example, we'll take an example of, if we are generating ideas to increase the number of quality researchers and innovators in India. This is a very topical thing that, the whole country is kind of putting efforts to increase the number of researchers, quality researchers, and also innovators. So what could be the constraints? Let's start putting, first of all, money. How you start releasing it, you start asking questions. Can we fund more research topics? So for example, if today the government of India or some government bodies funding 100 research topics, can we have, say, 150? Can we increase the research bursary? I mean, if you identify that, okay, the research associates or research scientists who work as part of their research or PhD, they are getting less salary or less bursary. Can we increase that bursary amount? Can we have some more best researchers awards so that, people are kind of coming forward and, doing quality research? So this is essentially the money constraint part. If you start asking these questions, you will have more ideas. From people side, you can ask, can we create an interest in science and technology from early age? So, if you assume that researcher doesn't happen or a quality or good researcher doesn't get born overnight. I mean, it has to be a process right from early stages of childhood and, you know, early stages of education, where you nurture those early researchers. So can we create that interest in science and technology from a very early age? Can we have top scientists to mentor your young professionals? So can we have some role models? So, you know, people who have kind of been successful in their professional and scientific career, can they spend some amount of time with, you know, people or students in school, you know, top students, to actually tell them about, you know, how this can be done? If you come to the space part, we can say that, you know, space again is kind of not space only in the traditional way. It could also be kind of the space that we live in. So we can say that, can we collaborate with outside India researchers? If it is already happening, can we increase it? Right. One click and, you know, everything gets on top. Yeah. So can we collaborate with outside India researchers, or can we attract you know, scientists from reputed global universities? So essentially, we are breaking the space barrier here. We are not only thinking about India. We are saying that, okay, if the world is your oyster, how can you have more, you know, collaboration, and how can you have more inputs coming from outside? So that is the space part. And the regulation part, probably, you know, right now what is happening is most of the central institutes, research institutes, or, you know, other things would, or even teaching, they are kind of pushing for PhD degrees. Now we have some fantastic researchers sitting in industry who have done a good amount of research in their own applied area, but they don't have a PhD degree. So, you know, can we release that regulation constraint that, okay, so you have to have a PhD degree to guide somebody on their PhD research? Can we have a non-PhD as a PhD guide? Or can we promote new thinking as part of that? So this is how we essentially you know, release the constraints and have more ideas coming. If ideas, you know, start to shrink or start to, you know, come lesser and lesser. Yeah. So now we have enough ideas. So we are moving into the third stage of, you know, so we had problem statement, we generated a lot of ideas. Now it is about how to process those ideas. You know, so we are going into a convergence mode. So earlier we were divergent. So we were not thinking about whether it's a bad idea or not relevant idea. But now it is a stage where we start filtering the ideas, or we start putting some constraints on the ideas. So how we do that? One very popular, again, part of design thinking only, one popular method that we use is DVF, which essentially uses three axes: desirability, viability, and feasibility. And we essentially score each idea on these three axes, and then take the scoring, and then take, say, probably top five ideas, top six ideas, based on the number of you know, resources that you have at your disposal. So let's go a bit more deeper into this. So desirability. What is desirability? So desirability is an angle where you ask a question: is this solution really needed? What are the, are we solving the right problem? Why can't we solve, why can't they solve it themselves? So what are the obstacles in the whole problem statement? So that's the desirability part. So in desirability, you are looking at the end users more, right? Or the end beneficiaries more. And you're saying, okay, looking from their angle, are we solving their right problem? Or, you know, I mean, take again example of that BRT system. If BRT is not getting used in Pune, and then they had to, you know, take it back, it means that it is not a desirable thing for people who actually want to use it. So probably we are not solving that problem. So that's the desirability part, which comes from the end users or from the stakeholders. Then second part is the viability part. So viability talks about financial sense. It's about money, right? So this first is D, second is V, viability. It asks questions of, you know, why would customer use it, or why would customer pay for it, rather, and how it will make money or save money or time or resources. So it essentially checks the whole viability part of your innovation or your idea. And the last part is feasibility part, which essentially means, is it actually doable? Is it actually, you know, possible to do using the technology that we have, or using the constraints about the legal compliance and government policy, etc., that we have, right? So these are the three axes where you score that idea. So take an again example of quality getting delayed, and you know, if one of the idea to that problem statement is that we will use you know, an a completely automated digital tablet based solution to quality control. Now if you have that as a solution or an idea, from the disability perspective, is the solution, are we solving the problem, are we, is this particular solution of using a tab going to spend going to reduce the time? Is a quality engineer going to be happy of using, or they will not like it doing using their iPad? Are they kind of educated in terms of the IT and the new technologies? No, that all part will be considered desirability. Coming to viability, you'll say, okay, if you want to do it on iPad, you'll probably need to develop a software which would take, say, $1 million as an expense. And you ask question, okay, if we spend $1 million on development of that software, how much time we are going to save in terms of quality checks, or how much time we are going to, how much money that we are going to gain because we ship more orders? And would this investment of $1 million, which we are making in, you know, developing this software for complete digital quality checks, is it worth it? So that's the viability part for this particular problem. In the feasibility part, you'll say, okay, it's just good that this particular solution is desirable by the end users. Quality engineers would like it. It also makes financially perfect sense. But are you going to be able to do it? I mean, is there a technology right now by which, by the use of which, you, if you just point your tablet with a camera onto a filtration system, will it be able to identify the defects? Or it will still be, okay, you point a camera, but then the quality engineers will have to identify the defects. So that's the feasibility. Would it be possible today? The second thing of feasibility is, okay, you do it using digital, but for example, quality engineers are certified quality engineers. So they have a certificate. Now that certificate is needed as part of the compliance to your customers. Now, if you're developing this software, would your customers agree that quality checks have been done by a software, not by a, you know, certified quality engineer? So that comes a compliance part. So when you score these this idea on these three, you'll probably get a score. And then, you know, based on each of ideas and their scores, you choose. I mean, based on these three criteria and scoring that we have done, this is the top idea, this is the second top idea, and then you decide and, you know, go ahead with it. Okay, any questions? We'll move to a new concept again in the idea filtration part, which is called as business value canvas. I think this is very, very important concept. This gives structure to your selected idea. So, you know, imagine that you have done this DVP, the DVR, and then you selected an idea which is digital, the software-based quality control. Now you have to actually give a structure of that idea to be able to execute it, right? So the most important part for the business value canvas is your value proposition. So what is the real value that you are trying to bring? So in this case, probably you are bringing the you know, the digital way or person independent way of quality checks. You are, you know, saving time by this much amount, etc. So what is your value proposition? What is your core, right? And this business value canvas, by the way, this is also called as business model canvas sometimes. And this is used by startups a lot. So if you are into, you know, your startup kind of journey, if you want to evaluate some of your ideas, it's very important tool to be, you know, to be practicing and knowing this, right? So you start with your value proposition. So what exactly is your value? Why customers are going to buy it? Then you go and identify, ठीक है, I mean, I have a value proposition, but who, what is my customer segment? Who are my customers, right? What they really, you know, comprise of. Then how I will build the customer relationship. So you have a value proposition, you have, you know, a targeted customer, but how you would join or bridge that gap? Now you have to reach to your customers or potential customers, right? So how you will establish those customer relationships? Would it be, you know, a B2C where you kind of go and talk to each of your customer and, you know, sell it to them? Or would it be through channel or whatever? So the next part comes as channels. That what are the different channels that you would actually go and sell your product to your customer? Whether it's an online channel or you want to open a shop and sell it there or whatever, right? So this becomes a the customer or end user or stakeholder part of this. Now you come to the partners and, you know, the resources part. So, okay, you have a value proposition, you have defined your customer segment, you have defined customer relationships and channel through which you will do it. But now who you are going to take help from to actually develop this? So who would be your key partners? Would it be the shopkeepers or the dealers in between, or if you want to partner with, say, Microsoft for your technology? So those are the key partners. Then key activities in terms of to be able to actually bring this product into the market, what are the key activities that you need to do, right? And the last one is key resources. What you will need? You will need probably a set of designers to design your product. You will need a coder to actually code and, you know, convert that into a digital quality control machine or whatever. So who are your key resources? Then comes your cost structure. So what is your cost structure? How you are going to spend? How much you are going to spend on what? And the last one is the revenue stream. So where you are going to earn? So this whole business value canvas is almost like a full picture of your idea. Because usually what happens is there is a very big gap between idea and execution. So a lot of people have a lot of ideas, but there is very few people are able to execute those ideas and, you know, generate value. So why is that gap? Because of all these things that, you know, you have to think through each and every one of these things to be able to convert your idea into something which is, you know, tangible or, you know, value adding. So if you follow this a very systematic way of creating a business value canvas for your business or for your idea, then you will get to know exactly where you want to work, exactly where you want to spend time. For example, you have everything populated really well, but you don't have you know, key resources, then you probably need to hire those. So, you know, you get to know exactly where you want to focus. So this seemingly is a completely different and new thing, but I want to again connect it back to our desirability, feasibility, and viability. If you kind of go in a bit deeper, these are the questions or these are the things which gets covered as part of this. So you have a value proposition, you ask questions about your customer segments, channels, and customer relationship, which is essentially kind of answering your desirability quotient, whether the people will use it and then how they are going to use it, how you are going to ship it to them. In terms of feasibility, yes, this is a great idea, great value proposition. You have people who are desirable, but, you know, to be able to actually physically convert it, who you would need? You know, you would need partners, you would need some activities, you would need, you know, key resources. And finally, viability. So what is going to be the cost of the whole project and how is going to be the revenue stream? So just wanted to connect what we learned earlier as the idea filtration stage, where we use, you know, these three D, V, and F, and then you know, business value canvas, which is a very expansive way to structure your idea and be able to very categorically say where you want to work on. But again, these two are connected. So if you you know, have that an abstract level connection, this is how it looks like. I'll just kind of keep this as an example, because you know, business value canvas, there would be a lot of examples on internet, but since Netflix is something which all of us you know consume as a service, this is a very good example of you know Netflix ka business value canvas, how they have put it. So you can see, and you know you will probably agree that the value proposition that Netflix brings, you know, absolutely 24/7 on-demand entertainment, view high definition shows, stream content, unlimited access, Netflix original, you know, all these are value propositions. So that is the core of their product. So they start from there. Okay, we have this product. Now, who are the segments? Now, what is the customer segmentation? So they say that we can actually, so they do a very interesting customer clustering also. So they do that 2000 preference clusters usage, right? I mean, how people will use it, who are our customer, what geography, what contents, what language. So they have identified their customers. Now we have a value proposition, we have customers, how your Netflix is going to reach to you. It's on demand, it's self-service, it's easy to use. You can just, you know, download the app, you can pay, start your subscription, start using it. What are the channels? Any device. So you can have it as an app on Android, you can have it on mobile through which you can use. How you will get to know about it, we'll advertise it on Facebook, Instagram as a social media. You will do a word of mouth, offline advertising, online advertising. So this is how you will, your value proposition will reach to your customers, I mean the channels. Now to be able to do that, what you need, you know, obviously you will need technology R&D, content licensing, content production, content distribution, data analytics, right? So these are the activities that they have highlighted. What you would need as a resources, obviously you will need an app or a website to be able to publish it. You'll need a platform, obviously you'll need employees, filmmakers, prices, awards, brand, right? So these are the key resources that you want to keep. What are the partners? You will need to first of all partner with the regulators, because you know this is completely, OTT is a completely new area, so you need that. You need someone like Amazon, AWS, so that you can host all your data. You don't want to be an IT company, you know, you are a film production company, so you don't want to be an IT company. So you need to use some of your partners in IT like Amazon to actually be able to do that. Film producers, film media producers, you know, absolutely needed as your partners, because you know, if you see initially there was a lot of resistance on releasing this new films and new shows on OTT, but now it's a good partnership model that is working out, right? So you need that. What's the cost structure? The whole cost of R&D and you know actually be able to do that, and then the revenue streams. So you have a subscription, you have a product placement, you have DVD rentals, and you know they are also, you know, coming up with a lot of Netflix originals, which means that they are not only gaining from the subscription but essentially licensing the Netflix own content to other providers as well. So this is an example of you know business value canvas or business model canvas, as they say, in context of Netflix, which we all know. Any questions? Any comments? Has anybody done business value canvas, business model canvas for their you know upcoming startup or their company or their idea? No? Okay. All right. So, right, we will move to the next phase now, which is again as part of idea filtration. So we saw desirability, viability, and feasibility, right? So that's a very good way to filter your ideas. But even a simpler way to do that is if you kind of segregate your ideas on a map of value versus complexity. So this is a simple 2x2 matrix. On x-axis, you have complexity, whether it's a technical complexity or a business complexity, and on y-axis you have value to the whoever is the stakeholder in that particular thing. So there are four quadrants. And if you score your idea out of 10 on both of these axes, so how complex is the idea and what value the idea will bring, then you will essentially get all your ideas scattered across these four quadrants. Now, the first quadrant, which is a very easy one to pick, is high value and low complexity. So that are typically, those are the ideas which are quick wins. So, you know, don't even think of it, just quickly do it and get value churning out. So those are the quick wins. Again, a very easy one to kind of eliminate is the one with high complexity and low value. So which are on the right bottom corner. So we don't throw it, we say on hold. And why is that? Is because these ideas may not be inherently bad. These ideas may be technically complex, probably because the technology has not evolved to that level, and that could change, right? I mean, probably few new discoveries in the technology phase, then suddenly those would kind of start becoming technically less complex. Even the value, sometimes it is not a realized value, right? So, but that would change quickly. So I'll give you a very, very good example of such idea in Indian market, where the specialized coffee concept, was very new, very, very new 2 or 3 years back, right? What I mean by specialized coffee is that if you can choose a particular coffee estate, you can choose the beans from that coffee estate. You can say whether you want, what kind of processing you want on that bean and what size you want them to be, grounded and roasted, and then send it to your home so that you can use it in your coffee machine to actually get a nice brewed coffee yourself. Now, this idea was pretty popular in Western world, particularly in America. And there were a lot of startups in that area. The same started coming in India as well. At that time, it was probably business complexity wise, it was too high. I mean, people were not actually getting the value for that. They are not really thinking about whether it is needed in Indian customers. But today, if you see, it has quickly moved into that quick wins, because it's not technologically complex. I mean, it's just a platform where you give access for people to choose their coffee beans and method and everything. And, the value, inherent value that they get is very high, because they get a very personalized, specially brewed for Aditya kind of a coffee. So it's kind of a very high sentimental value there. So these boxes are not stationary. They kind of, the ideas keep moving in these boxes based on time, based on technological advances as well. So the quick wins we saw, the on hold we saw, Q is this coffee example, where it's not technologically complex, but the value was not realized not 2-3 years back. Now suddenly the value is realized. So it kind of moved from quick wins to, in Q to quick wins. Now the last one, which is a strategic one, it's very important. It's technologically complex, but value is also high. So something like probably an example is a bullet train between, say, Mumbai Pune or Ahmedabad Pune, Ahmedabad Mumbai, right? So it's technologically very complex. It's not easy. It's not kind of something which you get it done in quick time. But it is also very high value. So these things or these such ideas actually are put in the strategic bucket, which means that there has to be slow and steady progress in making this a reality from both from the technology and business side. So I think, the ideas which are there, they're not eliminated, but they have a strategic groups and they keep working on those ideas. These are big projects. These are kind of strategic big projects. Okay, any question on idea filtration? This is a simpler method. I mean, sometimes feasibility, desirability and viability becomes a bit critical, and it's difficult to evaluate those ideas. A lot of times I use this kind of mechanism to start with. So I use this first, if I have say 20 ideas coming from a brainstorming session, I quickly kind of score these ideas into these things. And then I pick quick wins first, because that's where, you know, you start. And then use desirability, viability, feasibility. Because in quick wins, if you have say 10 ideas, then out of 10, I mean, I can't work on 10 ideas at a given point of time. So I need, you know, one or two ideas. So then I use the other method to actually, you know, I get the actual top two or three ideas which I can work on. Yeah. Okay. Any questions? Prachi, there are two chats in chat window. Are there any questions or just?
Yes, I'll just look it. Yes. Mr. Amit Nalavade. Okay, Komal Nalavade. So she's saying, I'll just read out what she has written.
Yeah.
Hello, I am Komal Nalavade. I actually don't know how the water management works for the particular city, but the problem is scarcity of water in summer. HMV would calculating and recording the amount of water supplied to different parts of the city and understanding the consumption of every year over a period of time to get the pattern of usage. As this is related to rivers and dams, paradigm shift would be not just constructing dams, but connecting rivers with country or channelize them. Within a country or channelize them.
Agree. So I think it's probably just a thought that she wanted to, you know, post, which is a very good and timely thought, right? Because sometimes these problems are not trivial. And where the problems are not trivial, you will definitely need a complete paradigm shift, like connecting rivers or, you know, building more dams is you know, probably easier logical step, but connecting rivers becomes entirely, you know, a paradigm shift. Nobody has done it before. So yeah, I think to the second part, yes. And to the first part of consumption, I think now it will get sorted, because at least in bigger cities, you have water meters now. So earlier, what used to happen is, if you are probably giving some cubic meter, some lakh cubic meter of water to say Pune city or any other city, you're not able to actually identify what is the leakage, first of all, and who is consuming what amount. And you are kind of charged at a very standard rate. But now if you see what has started happening is, for every residential unit, there is a water meter, which is a IoT based meter or, you know, connected meter, so that the central unit will actually get a very detailed consumption report of who is consuming what. And, you know, on top of that, they can do a lot of data analytics, which essentially would help if there is any anomaly that, okay, if there is a building which has say 10 residents, you know, and it's consuming way higher than the average building for 10 residents, you know, you can actually pinpoint that and send your engineer there to check whether there is any leakage or unnecessary use or unauthorized use of that water. So earlier, these things were not available. Now, slowly, because of the improving infrastructure, they are putting these things in, which will definitely help to solve the water issues, at least, you know, in many of these regions. Okay. Right. So we are moving from ideas. I think, yeah. So this is, again, a very, very interesting concept. It doesn't fall exactly into the idea filtration, but it is idea categorization, I would say. I mean, you won't really filter out ideas after you brainstorm. But this is a very good way to actually prioritize the features. So this is in a bit different context. So if you have, for example, a product like a car or a computer or, you know, your website, which is your product, right? And you are ideating on what new features you want to give as part of that website or car or, you know, whatever product you have. So Kano model is a Japanese scientist who discovered this model, and it is again very widely used in the innovation stream. You have two axes here. So one axis is the requirements axis, so customer requirements axis, and second axis is the customer happiness axis. So on the left hand side of your half, or left hand side half is where the requirements are not fulfilled. The right hand side half is where the requirements are fulfilled. The top half is where the customer is happy. The bottom half is where the customers are unhappy. Now there are three types of requirements typically, or features, right? The first type of feature is what we call as a performance feature or performance requirement. So these are very specific, measurable, expressed requirements by customers. And usually they follow more the better type of approach. So if you give more, so just a mileage, you know, if a vehicle gives, say, 25 kmpl, you will be happy. If it gives 45 kmpl, you will be more happy. So it's kind of more the better, you know, this line is where these requirements fall, and you know whether the customer is happy or not. Then you have must have requirements. So these are the requirements which are usually implied, right? I mean, they are not stated requirements, they are implied requirements, but which are taken for granted by the end users. And if you don't meet any of these requirements, there is a huge drop in the customer unhappiness. So you see, this is not a linear curve. The purple curve drops very drastically even the moment you go slightly on the negative x-axis, which means that any of these requirements which are unmet suddenly will, you know, decrease the customer happiness. And then there are requirements which are kind of nice to have or attractive requirements. These are again unexpressed. These are not expressed by people, but very slight positive movement in this direction. So even if you meet some part of that requirement, there is a sudden increase in the happiness of the customer, right? So this is the Kano chart. Now what we do is, any ideas or any features that you want to put as part of your product or service, you plot on this, you know, whether it's a performance requirement, whether it's a must-have requirement, or whether it's a attractive requirement, and is it met or not. And you try to stay on the customer happiness kind of scale, positive customer happiness scale, right? Just to give it more clarity into that, I will give one example of each of such requirements. So the performance requirement is typically a car top speed above 120. So if a car manufacturer has a top speed of his or her vehicle as say 120. Now, if there is an idea which increases that top speed by say 5 km/h, so it makes it 125. So it's a typical performance requirement where, you know, customers will definitely be happy. Yare, 120 top speed tha, abhi 125 ho gaya. But it's a linear increase. But 125 ka 130 ho gaya, it will again, you know, so it's a linear performance requirement, which if you kind of add more to it, you will get more happier customers. Now, the must-have requirement these days is a air conditioning unit in a car. So it's nobody these days, at least, you know, tell the car makers as a voice of customer that we need to have a working air conditioning unit. Earlier it used to be, you know, in the times of say Fiat Premier, Padmini, and you know, Maruti 800, there used to be two models, say AC chahiye and non-AC chahiye. But nowadays in, you know, consumer cars, you know, there is hardly a non-AC car. I mean, all are AC cars, right? So it's almost like a must-have requirement. So if a model comes where you don't have an option of air conditioning, it's a drastic customer happiness. Nobody will buy that car. Nobody has told you as a car manufacturer, ki AC chahiye. But, you know, it's kind of a given requirement. So you can't really play, or, you know, you can't really fiddle negatively with those requirements. And attractive example of attractive requirement in a car scenario is a connected car features. Ki, you know, your car is connected and you can operate it using your app, and you can, you know, start and stop, and you can, you know, put an air conditioning on before you 10 minutes before you sit in the car so that it is nicely, you know, cozy, etc. Right? So these are, at least now, these are, you know, attractive requirements, which means that ekad car mein tumhe just start, remote start stop ka bhi, you know, ye diya ya unlock lock ka bhi diya using your app, the customer will be really happy because the customer is not really expecting it at this moment, but you are giving it. So this is another way of prioritizing your features. Which features you want to release first, which features you want to put inside your product first, and you know which can wait for later. And it's very important to understand that, again, similar to the boxes that I have shown earlier, the ideas or the features that you plot on these particular Kano model also are dependent on time, place, and industry, right? So, so air conditioning, particularly in a car, it wasn't a must-have requirement probably in like 10 years before. It was probably a performance requirement. Ki are AC acha chalta hai na uska, aur AC ka performance kaise acha hai na. So it was more of a performance requirement. If you go 30 years or 40 years before, then it was almost like a attractive requirement. Ki are ye car mein AC bhi hai, right? So it is a function of time. It is again not stationary. I mean, it is function of place also. So for example, heater. I mean, heater in a car in Pune probably is, you know, it's not, I mean, it doesn't even fall anywhere here. I mean, people will not even get happy if you have a heater in car. But if you move to a colder state within India, or even if you move to some other countries, I think it becomes almost a, you know, must-have requirement. Right? So again, a very important model or a framework to actually categorize your ideas and prioritize your ideas. Yeah. Okay, so we have 15 minutes. So I'll quickly go through some of these things. Now, again, if you, you know, remember the innovation process, we had problem statement, we had kind of seen some tools for that. Then we had idea generation, idea filtration. Now it is coming to the testing of the ideas. So fail fast approach is absolutely important. So the two steps before actually deployment, or rather three steps, which was POC, POV, and pilot. These are essentially prototypes. We call it prototypes in a generic world. So why prototypes are important, what are the objectives of prototype is, it gives you a peek into the future. So how this will work, you know, kya hoga, exactly kaise dikhega, kya fayda hoga, kya kaise function karega. It also helps you to anticipate the obstacles. So if there are any potential obstacles, whether it's a technical obstacle or a usage obstacle, which is going to come in future, you're really getting a test of it right when you prototype. You can test your hypothesis. You know, if you have made some hypothesis on designing the problem and solution, then you can test it. You can test your technical feasibility, right? So that's why prototypes are very important. And so there is a map of various different types of prototypes, which essentially you can do. And, you know, some are analytical prototypes, some are physical prototypes, some are tangible and intangible. And you can see various things which you may not probably have seen as a prototype, but you know, it is by definition a prototype, because you are getting some more information about your solution by presenting that or by working on that. Some of these you are probably, you know, well aware that, you know, in design particularly, they do a lot of paper prototyping. You know, these days for IT, you use a lot of UI, UX, you know, user interface, user experience prototyping, which is essentially screenshots, and you create it as a dummy app, where you know you have all the functionalities but not actually the product. In automotive or any big industries like medical devices, etc., there is a physical prototype which is a must. There is also a CAD prototype, so complete user digital mock-up of factory, digital mockup of your car, etc. So these are all different types of prototypes that you can build. in any project or in any innovation, you use multiple of these. It's not only that you use one, you use multiple of these, right? It's important to see the difference between proof of concept and proof of value. I've told you earlier, but just wanted to highlight, and I want to also bring a new concept of proof to market or proof of market. So proof of concept essentially is where you focus on the feasibility of of the whole design or all the solution, and try to test the hypothesis by answering question, can this be made, or can this be designed, or can this be manufactured? So that is a proof of concept. Proof of value is where you focus on the viability and try to answer a question or a hypothesis by answering question, can we make or save money? How much would be the benefit to the stakeholders? So it's more to the value. Now, earlier, only these two were used. The third one is a bit tricky, which is proof of market, where you need to really see the see the market in the actual marketplace and see if there is a real need for this in the market. So to test the desirability part, you are actually using this proof of market, which is not very popular right now, but people have started using it. For example, we were working with one of the insurance companies, and they wanted to bring a new insurance product into the market. What they did is they obviously did the proof of concept and proof of value, and then they were satisfied that yes, this product is making all business sense and it is feasible. But now, do you really do people really need this, and would there be uptake? So they actually created a complete social experiment where they created a different company, because this they don't want to probably put it as their name, because then it's already in the market. Na? So if you're a company A, what you do is you create a small company, a hypothetical company B, and using the digital network internet channels, you actually push your product, a company A's product, on the name of company B. And you track all the response to that. So essentially, you are tracking the proof of market. And then once you are satisfied, yes, this is a needed product, people are buying it, or at least people are showing interest, then you actually, actually ship your product. So this is a new concept. Not many use it very frequently, but wanted to just highlight and show it to you. Yeah. I think we will take a logical break here, because I also wanted to cover a very important method, which is trees, but I don't think there is enough time for us to cover it in proper depth. So we will probably take a logical break here and go for any questions, reflections on today's session, what you understood, what you did not understand, and then we can close it. It's okay, Prachi?
Yes, yes, Dr. Aditya.
Yeah. Okay, so...
Participants, please talk, because we have been requesting you, if you have any questions, or if you have any comments, if you have to say anything about the session, if you would like to like us to cover certain points which have been not yet discussed.
Yeah.
It can be anything. But please speak up so that we will get to know how it is going also, whether you're, what are your expectations and so on. Whether you want to share any similar kind of things that were discussed in general about innovation, if you want to say something. We can open the forum for discussion and then things will fall in place, I feel.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I can see, yes, Mr. Sunil, you can unmute yourself and ask. Or you can type your question in the chat box, anything will do. Hello? We can't hear you, Mr. Sunil.
Yeah, I think are they able to unmute themselves?
Yeah, they are.
Okay. Can somebody try unmuting?
I'm not able to.
Hello.
Yeah,
previously I was not able to unmute because it says he like voice is not allowing to. Yeah. So yeah, Aditya, please can you go to that scale up wala process, that proof of concept to scale up wala slide?
Okay. This one?
Yeah, this one. So I'm from biotech market. So like right. Most of the time right. I also saw that like most of the time like proof of concept and the pupil do generate like they don't focus on like solution or architecture, like they don't spend lots of time on solution or architecture. They directly jump on proof of concept to generate like to attract the more funding and other things. And that's why I did saw like after like pilot and scale up process, they have to restart the process from like the solution part of the thing.
So I think solution and architecture is a very important step. And sometimes what happens is people solution for proof of concept. So what I mean by that is when you have some idea, ideally your solution or architecture should be for that scale up, isn't it? And then, so it's like you have an idea of, developing a new biotechnology ka kuch machine, and then you have to have a solution ready for the end scaling up version of that. Now after you have that solution, you actually do a proof of concept, a smaller concept. Typically what people do is they actually from idea they directly
jump on pilot
into proof of concept, which means that the solution is never complete. And then, that's a miss from I think their end. Usually, as process suggests, I think you should have a full solution ready and amendable for changes. So I think another big mistake is some people who are more solution oriented, so they take pride in their solution so much so that even after doing the proof of concept, proof of value, if there are any shortcomings in their solution, they are not ready to accept. They say, no, this is the solution. So I think that is this on the second part of the spectrum where, people are, so adamant about their solution and their architecture that they are not ready to change even after seeing some feedback from the market. So I think that's another thing. But yeah, I think what you are saying is right, and that there are these things that happen, and it's very subconscious level. I mean, that's why I say that following this innovation process is very important, because this innovation process has been standardized based on what people anyways follow. So it's like if there is no innovation process, still some people will follow this, some people will kind of miss some steps of it and follow that. So what has happened is after years of observation and study, people have said, okay, most of the people will follow this, but by going by their gut feeling, they might miss some steps. So just to ensure that it is all structured, they have put this process in. So that's why it's very important to, really follow the process and then, go step by step.
Yeah. And the second question is regarding the design thinking kind of thing. So in biotech market space, I don't see a great example in that, like regarding to design thinking approach ke base pe koi business, because we don't have a like kuch aisa customer base kuch hai nahi ja raha tha. Diagnosis produce kar rahe, but we can like most of the time it's happened ki like technology transfer ho ja raha hai ya to kisi company ko rights bech karke si profit share kar rahe hai. So wahan par, and there is like concept like ki like design like आइडिया जब जनरेट कर रहे हैं तो उसी में कॉस्ट कटिंग एंड पहले से स्टार्ट करने का जो अभी क्या उसको क्वालिटी बाय डिजाइनिंग समथिंग अप्रोच कहते हैं, तो हाँ, सो ये सारी चीजें हो रही है, बट डिजाइन थिंकिंग वाला प्रोसेस में बायोटेक मार्केट में बहुत रेयरली देख रहा हूँ. So that is very interesting. Mm-hmm. How we can you are a person जो बहुत सारे different field में लोगों को consult करते हो and साथ में काम करते हो, how what trend are you seeing in India perspective and other countries के how people are moving in on that dimension in biotech startup and biotech company venture?
Yeah, so I think if your business is B2C, so direct to consumer, right? If you are selling your product direct to consumer, in those areas, whether it is biotech or any other, I think there has to be design thinking naturally coming in, because it's very easy to deploy design thinking there. If it is B2B, for example, if you are providing some technology to some other company, right, then I agree with you that the design thinking is not that intuitive, because getting that empathy, because you are never seeing the end user. I'm not very close to biotech, but I'll give you an example of, again, automotive, which everyone understands. So there is, a pedal, accelerator pedal of automotive, right? And if somebody else is designing it, not Maruti, Maruti is actually getting it as a outsourced part from somebody. Now that somebody who is kind of a vendor of Maruti, who is designing that accelerator pedal, for that organization to deploy design thinking is very difficult, because they are not seeing the end user. They are actually just an intermediary who are giving it to Maruti, and then Maruti is selling it to end user. But for somebody who is actually selling it to end user, their product, I think it comes very naturally. And to be honest, it has been a recent phenomenon, this design thinking. So, it started with the companies like Google, Apple, Netflix. They have started using it heavily. It is not yet openly used in traditional companies. So, but it will come. I think it has already started. If you see the number of courses, simple number of courses on digital and also physical universities on design thinking, it will definitely be a big phenomenon, and everybody will start using it. It's like Six Sigma in 1990s. When GE got into this Six Sigma methodology, probably it took a good 10 years for the world to understand and get worse with it. But everybody started using it after that. I think similar thing will happen with design thinking.
And the concept of proof of I am aware about proof of concept and proof of value, but the concept of proof of market is very new. It is very interesting. You can design a basic experiment and can directly test the in real market setup kind of thing.
Exactly.
And that is for biotech person, kind of bio entrepreneur kind of me, it is very new thing. And in future I will be using this kind of thing to test out that is very interesting thing.
I think this is a new concept, so
thank you.
Okay, do we have any other questions?
Okay, so if not, you can always ask on the group also.
Absolutely.
If you have to discuss further. And yes, thank you so much for joining, everyone. Hope you the course is useful for you, and please feel free to interact and ask questions to Dr. Aditya on the group also. So thank you so much. We will be meeting on next Saturday, same time, 11 o'clock, for the third and the last session of the course. Dr. Aditya, would you like to say something?
No. Prachi ma'am, Sucheta here. Can we get the PPT? Because sometimes, going through video takes time. If you can share it somewhere on SlideShare or something. Because, we want to refer, but video, it takes a lot of time to reach to that point. So if PPT, we can quickly, scroll and see there.
It depends on the speaker, actually.
I'm okay to share the PPT. If you have a place where you can host it, etc., I will just send it across.
So what you can do is you can make a PDF and send it to us, or you can directly put it on the group also.
Okay.
That also would do.
Perfect. I'll do that.
Yes. Also, the session we would be uploading it on our YouTube channel by, let's say, tomorrow or by Monday. So you would be able to see it there also.
Perfect.
So only problem with the video is, you know, when we want to reach to a particular point, it takes a lot of time to search.
Got your point. Yes, we'll be sharing the PDF also of the presentation. No problem.
Okay. So I think in the next session, just so that everyone understands. So next session, we will cover the trees concept, which is a very interesting concept that we will cover. And we will then look at two things. One is the new technology trends, again, at a very surface, which are the new technology trends which are driving today's digital innovation. And we will look at what roles and skill sets are needed for innovators. So what roles innovators play and what skill sets are needed. So that would be our next session.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Aditya.
Thanks
all the participants. See you all on next Saturday. Bye.
Talk to you on next Saturday. Bye-bye.